internal combustion engines we are discussing, and we said that these engines work in a cycle. It may be a four stroke engine, it may be a two stroke engine. In the case of four stroke engine, after completion of all the four strokes, it is said that one cycle is completed. If it is two stroke engine, then we are saying the completion of two strokes resulting into a completion of one cycle. So always these internal combustion engines are working in a cycle. So in today's lecture, we'll be discussing what these cycles are. What are the ideal cycles? What are the actual cycles? What is the difference between all these cycles? How the efficiency is different in different cycles? So these basics we'll be studying. The foremost cycle is Carnot cycle, which is most efficient, and it is also termed as air standard cycle. Name air standard has been given here because working medium, working fluid in this cycle is air. If air is working medium, we are assuming that composition of this air during the cycle, the properties of air, particularly its specific heats, will remain constant. However, in a cycle, heat is added, and if we are adding heat, temperatures are also changing. But we are assuming in air standard cycle that Cp and Cv value of air is constant. Same time, as it is shown in this figure, left hand side, if you see, heat is being added, and heat is added to air, which is working fluid. So source of heat is outside the system where air exists. So outside the system, heat source exists. Heat is being, just you see this source we are showing here, it is heat source, and this heat source is giving heat to working fluid air. So the piston surface and the space which is available here, it is carrying air, heat is being added from outside. So in air standard cycle, assumption is that working medium is air, the properties of air remains constant throughout the cycle, and heat is being added from outside the system. The movement of the piston is giving work output. Here you can say this line indicates here heat addition, and that heat addition is from outside source. When we are adding heat, piston is moving, when piston is moving, volume is increasing. Due to heat addition, temperature should increase, but as volume is increasing here, the increase in volume will be resulting into decrease in temperature. But from another side, we are adding heat, that is trying to increase the temperature. So net effect, this line is isothermal process. Isothermal process means temperature remains constant, or pressure into volume. P is vertical axis, V is horizontal axis. Multiplication of this P and V is constant. Up to this point, we are adding heat here. And after that, this external heat source we are removing. We'll remove this heat source from here, and top of the piston is insulated. No exchange of heat from outside. And the reversibility of the system is also assumed here. It is assumed during this process, when heat is being transferred, to the system. So this process is externally is not reversible, because heat exchange is taking place. So externally it is not reversible, but internally we are assuming that the process of heat addition is internally is reversible. Meaning of internally reversible is between cylinder and piston there is no friction. So when we are defining reversibility, we are defining in two ways. One is externally reversible, another one is internally reversible. Externally reversible we are saying when there is no heat exchange. Internally reversible we are saying when there is no friction. So when heat addition is taking place at constant temperature, that time the process is internally reversible but not externally. After this point, when heat source has been removed and still the piston movement is taking place from this B to C. A to B process was internally reversible. B to C, now because heat source has been removed from here, no heat addition to this system, and same time it is assumed that there is no friction also. So B to C, the process is externally as well as internally reversible, and sometimes it is being said the process is reversible adiabatic process. Adiabatic means no heat transfer, and reversible adiabatic means externally as well as internally it is reversible. So from B to C expansion process is taking place. Again, what is being done for completing the cycle? Initially we said that for the operation of an engine, the process the cycle has to be completed. So from C to B, and again bringing the system from B to A at same point from where we have started, heat rejection process from C to D, and that is in place of this heat source which I indicated here. We are bringing a cold body, we are removing the insulation which was put on the top dead center of the cylinder. So that time this air will be rejecting its heat to that cold body. Here this process C to D, it is heat rejection process. Now during C to D process, because heat exchange is taking place, internally it is reversible, but externally it is not reversible, means heat exchange is taking place. Still we are assuming that because there is no friction between cylinder and piston, so from C to D process will remain internally reversible, and finally at D we'll be removing that cold body also from here. D to A compression is taking place of air, and again piston will be reaching to same state, the cycle will be completed. So some of the assumptions which we have made here. One, we said here heat addition is at constant temperature, process is internally reversible. From B to C, there is no heat addition, system and the whole system is internally as well as externally reversible. From C to D, heat rejection is taking place, it is only internally reversible. And finally from D to A, again process is reversible, it is reversible adiabatic. So this heat addition is at constant temperature, heat rejection is at constant temperature, means this is isotherm, this one is isotherm, this one is reversible adiabatic, this one is reversible adiabatic. So assumptions which we are making here, that in two processes there is no heat exchange, there is no friction. During heat addition and heat rejection there is no friction, and working fluid is air, as well as heat rejection and heat addition is through external source. That also an assumption, and we are assuming that the properties of air during this whole cycle, when cycle is completed, the properties of air remains constant, particularly Cp and Cv values. These are the major assumptions in air standard cycle. It is most efficient cycle, but not 100%. Again, I am saying this Carnot cycle, which is converting heat into work, heat is taken from external source, that is getting converted into work. The area of this diagram is equal to work output. Yes, total work output which you are getting, that is equal to this area. And the efficiency of this cycle is highest among all the cycles which are used for the purpose of heat engines, but it is not 100% efficient because some of the heat will have to reject to surrounding. So highest efficiency it is having. All the cycles, actual, when this Otto cycle or diesel cycle or Atkinson cycle or Joule cycle, any cycle which you are using for the purpose of conversion of heat into work, they are less efficient in this cycle. However, all they are also air standard cycles, but this cycle which is converting heat into work, taking heat at constant temperature, rejecting heat at constant temperature, this is most efficient cycle, but not 100% cycle, because from B to C intensely we are rejecting heat to surrounding, which is wastage, and that's why its efficiency is not 100%. The heat addition process may be different also. In Carnot cycle, we said heat addition and heat rejection is at constant temperature. Whereas another type of heat addition process can be, here also you can see on PV diagram, the heat addition to the system may be at constant pressure also. When pressure remains constant, vertical axis again is indicating constant pressure. Here it is in A subhead, it is isobaric. Isobaric means your pressure remains constant during heat addition process. In the heat addition process, your pressure remains constant. This type of cycle is diesel cycle. This one at B, if you see PV equal to C, you can remember that during Carnot cycle we have said that during heat addition process, multiplication of P to V is constant. It is isothermal process, isothermal heat addition process. Another type of heat addition process may be, or another type of process may be, in fact, not heat addition process, I should not say, this PV, it is expansion process. Here it is PV gamma equal to constant when there is no heat exchange process, but process is adiabatic process. Adiabatic process, we are saying, when there is no heat exchange. From the surrounding to the surrounding, there is no heat exchange. The type of process is termed as adiabatic process. And this process, D, you see, here this heat addition process is taking place at constant volume. Pressure, x-axis is volume. Here volume remains constant during heat addition process. This type of heat addition process is taking place in the case of Otto cycle. These two examples I am taking here, constant pressure heat addition, it is in diesel cycle. Constant temperature heat addition, it is in Carnot cycle. Constant volume heat addition, it is in the case of Otto cycle. Most efficient process of heat addition for converting maximum amount of heat into work is this constant temperature heat addition process. In heat addition during constant volume as well as heat addition during constant pressure, both the processes are creating some irreversibility in the system, in the cycle, and that's why these heat addition processes are less efficient as compared to when heat addition is taking place at constant temperature. So these are the assumptions. I said air standard cycles. So all the cycles which are I was discussing, it may be Carnot cycle where heat addition is at constant temperature. Another cycle I said heat addition is at constant pressure, that is diesel cycle. Another cycle I said heat addition at constant volume, that is Otto cycle. All those cycles are termed as air standard cycles, and during these air standard cycles, some of the assumptions which are being made. First, we are saying working fluid is air and it is behaving just like an ideal gas. Working fluid is air and air is behaving just like an ideal gas. Another assumption we are making that all the processes are internally reversible. That again I said, when either it is heat addition process or expansion process, between cylinder and piston there is no friction. So all the processes in the cycle are internally reversible. At some stages it may be externally reversible also, particularly at the time of expansion and at the time of compression. When there is no heat transfer, when there is no friction, then these are externally reversible also. But it can be said that all the processes which are taking place, at least they are internally reversible. There is no friction between cylinder and piston. Then we are saying the combustion process is replaced by heat input from the external source. There is no combustion inside the cylinder because only air is available, no fuel is there. So there is no combustion, no heat addition inside the cylinder. The heat source which we are having, it is outside the cylinder. Even the heat rejection process which is there, that heat rejection is also with the help of a cold body. The cold body is outside the cylinder, and after completion of this heat rejection process, the fluid is achieving its initial state. When it is achieving the initial state, then we'll be saying that cycle has been completed. So it is clear from here that engine is working in a cycle and the properties of working fluid is not changing. The processes which are taking place during whole cycle, at least they are internally reversible, and heat source or heat rejection is with the help of cold body or hot body which exists outside the cylinder. This is air Schneider cycle, but in actual case, the actual engines which are working, they are not handling only air. They let to generate heat, and that heat is generated inside the cylinder. If it is generated inside the cylinder, then inside the cylinder some fuel has to be. So the assumption which we had here for air Schneider cycle, it won't work when fuel we are using. If it is petrol engine, we are using petrol we are mixing during suction process inside a carburetor, and during suction homogeneous mixture we are supplying to the cylinder. So during suction process, not only air is available inside the cylinder, it is air plus fuel vapors. If air plus fuel vapors are, first of all, their properties are different. Properties of air is different, properties of petrol vapors are different, their CP CV values are different, and even when temperatures are changing, particularly at the time of compression, if same mixture is compressed, temperatures are changing, and when temperatures are becoming significantly higher, then value of CP and CV changes. Even in the case of air, only if you are having air and temperature is more than 1000 degrees Celsius, the value of CP and CV both increases always. But here assumption is, whatever the temperature of cycle may be, that in air Schneider cycle, the property of air, particularly CP CV value, remains constant. So air Schneider cycle, where working medium is air, Otto cycle, where working medium, again it is being assumed as air, but in actual petrol engine which is working on Otto cycle, air is not working fluid, it is having air plus fuel vapors. Those air plus fuel vapors are sucked into the cylinder, same are compressed inside the cylinder. After compression, combustion is initiated. Combustion is initiated means inside the cylinder. So the releasing heat inside the cylinder process is inside the cylinder only, whereas in the case of air Schneider cycle, the source of heat was outside the cylinder. In this case, due to combustion, heat source is inside the cylinder. That's the difference in fuel air cycle and air Schneider cycle. There is a difference. One, the cycle is having fuel with air. Another one, the source of heat is not outside the cylinder, source of heat is inside the cylinder, and it is not necessary that system is internally reversible also. That is all not necessary, but in the case of fuel air cycle, still our assumption will be system is internally reversible. So similarity between air standard cycle and fuel air cycle is the assumption which we are having, that the whole cycle, the all four processes which are taking place are internally reversible. That assumption still holds good here, but difference which is coming here, in the case of fuel air cycle, your working fluid is changing. Working fluid is not only air, it is carrying air plus fuel vapors. If it is diesel, then suction and compression, again working fluid is air, but now fuel is injected inside the cylinder, combustion is taking place inside the cylinder. After that, combustion products also will be there inside the cylinder. So that assumption of having only air as working fluid, it won't be true. Again, heat addition is inside the cylinder, not from outside. The heat addition in the case of diesel cycle, it is at constant pressure we are assuming, and air heat addition is inside the cylinder. So in fuel air cycle, in the case of diesel engine also, that working fluid in part of the cycle, it will be air plus fuel vapors or air plus combustion products, and heat addition is inside the cylinder itself. So air standard cycle and fuel air cycle is different in some of the processes, in some of the sequences it is different. One parameter of working fluid which we are saying specific heat, we are explaining like this one. Here some heat source we are having, one closed system we are having, which is having cylinder and piston mechanism. Here working fluid is, suppose, air here. This pressure which we are maintaining on air, it is a constant pressure. Working medium is air, and we are adding heat into this one. Due to addition of heat, the molecules of air will get more velocity, they'll be moving faster. Faster the movement of molecules mean there is increase in temperature. So when we are defining specific heat, some of the parameters we'll have to keep constant. Here pressure we are keeping constant. At constant pressure we are adding heat. So here I am saying gas at constant pressure. The working fluid is say air, it is being maintained at constant pressure, and to this gas we are adding heat. When we are adding heat, its temperature has to increase. We are observing here, we are assuming here that mass of this gas which we are having here, it is unit mass. It may be 1 gram, it may be 1 kilogram. Suppose we are assuming the mass of this gas is 1 kilogram. We are adding to heat to this one, and we are waiting for the time when its temperature will increase by 1 degree Celsius. So measurement of heat will be doing at constant pressure. We are saying that amount of heat added to this system which is resulting into increase of this gas by 1 degree Celsius. So we are saying the amount of heat which can increase its temperature by 1 degree Celsius, that heat is termed as specific heat. In one case your pressure can constant, if pressure is constant, if you are adding heat, even the movement of the piston is possible. Yes, the piston can move in upward direction when temperature is increasing. Another case, the piston, the movement of the piston, we can restrict, we can say that movement of piston is not allowed, we are adding heat from this side. In that case, your volume will remain constant, piston won't be moving and volume will remain constant. So heat addition may be at constant volume. In another case, heat addition can be at constant pressure. When we are adding heat at constant pressure, amount of heat added for increasing the temperature of gas by 1 degree Celsius, it is termed as specific heat at constant pressure. For increasing 1 degree Celsius temperature, amount of heat which is needed is specific heat while keeping pressure constant. Another situation may be we are keeping volume constant and then we are adding heat. That heat is, or specific heat is explained like this one: amount of heat added to the system for increasing temperature by 1 degree Celsius while keeping volume constant. So unit of Cp will be, it is Cp is equal to joule per kg per degree Kelvin. Joule is amount of heat, per kg means for increasing temperature of 1 kg of gas, that is by 1 degree Celsius. So joule per kg per degree Kelvin, it is amount of heat at constant pressure, that is Cp. If it is Cv, if volume is constant, again unit is same. The joule per kg per degree Kelvin, but always your Cp value is greater than Cv, because in the case of constant pressure process, when we are adding heat, the movement of piston is possible. Piston can move in upward direction. So the amount of heat which is being added, it is doing two jobs. In fact, one is trying to increase the temperature and same time piston is moving. So some work output from the system, it is also there. So for increasing temperature by 1 degree Celsius, the amount of heat which will be required will be more, because that he has to do two assignments. One, the job of increasing the temperature, another one to accomplish the work output from the system to surrounding. So always Cp value is greater than Cv. The difference of Cp and Cv is also important. Cp and Cv difference is also important. So here in the cycles, when we are discussing, when we are assuming working medium as air, the specific heat at every temperature we are assuming constant. But in actual cases, in actual behavior of gases, the Cp value at one temperature it is constant, but when temperatures are increases, even for increasing the temperature by 1 degree Celsius of that gas, the amount of heat required will be different. But in the case of air standard cycle, we are assuming whatever the temperature inside the cylinder may be, your value of specific heat remains same. Now this air standard cycle, if variation in specific heat is taking place, here this firm line, the solid line, solid line 1, 2, 3, 4, it indicates ideal Otto cycle, air standard Otto cycle, 1, 2, 3, 4, yes. But when fuel has been added with air, in petrol engine I said fuel has been added and then it is being compressed from 1 to 2. The line is dotted line. It is not following the same line which if only air as air would have been compressed. It is not following the same line. The line is now deviating. The line is lower than the line as compared to 1 and 2. The 1 to 2 dash, it is lower than the line which is not now having only air. It is having air plus fuel vapors. Reason for lowering this line is in fuel air cycle this line will be lower, or after compression the pressure which will be achieving as compared to air standard cycle, after compression the pressure which we are able to obtain, that value will be lower. Reason for that is now it is having mixture of air plus fuel vapors and this mixture is having higher value of CP, means for increasing temperature of this fluid increasing by 1 degree Celsius, the amount of heat which will be required, that will be much more. Here in this case from 1 to 2 dash, work input is being given, work input is finally is getting converted into heat, and that heat is not raising the temperature of the fluid up to 2, only up to 2 dash, because CP value of this actual working fluid is higher, temperatures are lower. So in the case of fuel air cycle, after compression the temperature which you are receiving, it is lower. If it is lower after compression and same amount of heat is being added at constant volume, one is from 2 to 3, if 2 dash to 3 dash, if same change in pressure we are observing due to heat addition, if it is the amount is same, even with same amount the same pressure we are not achieving, because initial pressures are lower. It means after heat addition the pressure will be lower, and when expansion process is taking place, here in the case of ideal air standard cycle, expansion of air is taking place from 3 to 4, but in the case of fuel air cycle, here there will be burnt products. When combustion is going on, there will be burnt products where CV value will be again different here. It is CV value or CP value of a mixture of number of gases. And for assessing the value of CP and CV, there are different methods. One is Genoff table, then many programs are available, computational programs are available. With the help of that one, actual CP CV value of the expanding products we can calculate. But it is certain that after expansion, the pressure which we are receiving, it is at 4 dash, much lower than 4. Much lower than 4, it means the gap between 4 and 4 dash, 3 and 3 dash, the gap which is there, it is responsible for the deviation of fuel air cycle as compared to ideal air standard cycle. So one difference between fuel air cycle and ideal air standard cycle is that variable specific heat we are assuming when the fuel air cycle is taking place, 1, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, it is variable specific heat, and 1, 2, 3, 4, we are assuming that working fluid is air and specific heat remains constant. So this difference is coming between air standard cycle and fuel air cycle. Another one is the presence of fuel. The presence of fuel inside the cylinder, it is changing the equilibrium inside the cylinder also. In the combustion products, equilibrium of the combustion products, the rate at which they are burning, the type of combustion process which is taking place inside the cylinder, it is also making difference inside the cylinder. Here I compared air fuel ratio of gasoline and diesel engines. Air fuel ratio is mass of air divided by mass of fuel. Per cycle, in a cycle, the amount of air which is going inside the cylinder and amount of fuel which is going inside the cylinder, the ratio of this one on the mass basis, if I am calculating the mass of air which is going inside the cylinder per cycle or mass of fuel which is going inside the cylinder. Ratio of this one is air fuel ratio. In the case of diesel engine, these air fuel ratio values are very high, say around 60. I am saying normal operation, more or less normal operation, when load on the diesel engine is significantly lower, that time value of air fuel ratio is around 60. Very small amount of fuel, very large amount of air is available inside the cylinder. In contrary to this one, in gasoline engine here you see, for normal operation of the engine, air fuel ratio is 14.7 to 1, means 14.7 kg of air needs 1 kg of gasoline. Whereas in this case, 60 kg of air needs 1 kg of fuel. This reason, very small amount of fuel, very large amount of air. Here, significant amount of fuel needs this much amount of air. So, in the case of diesel engines, the amount of air which is required by in the combustion process, that amount is much more as compared to gasoline engines. So, at significant lower loads, when very low loads on the engine are there, that time fuel consumption of diesel engine is very low as compared to gasoline engine. These are the limits also I am indicating here. Limits of air fuel ratio I am indicating. This x axis is showing air fuel ratio. It is increasing. It is increasing 9, 15, 19, like this one, it is increasing. This line which I am showing here, the dotted line which I am showing here, it is chemically correct air fuel ratio. This one chemically correct, or sometimes we are saying stoichiometric air fuel ratio, and this value is 15. Meaning of this 15 air fuel ratio is 15 kg of fuel, if it is having 1 kg of 15 kg of air, if it is having 1 kg of fuel, then combustion will be complete. The combustion products will be having only carbon dioxide, water vapors and nitrogen. The combustion will be complete, so it is chemically correct. The left hand side of this one is having excess fuel, means air fuel ratio is less than 15. It is less than 15. This mixture is in the richer region. This side is rich side. Rich side means availability of oxygen, availability of air is less, availability of the fuel for the purpose of combustion which is available inside the cylinder is more. The right hand side of this dotted line, it is having air fuel ratio more than 15. More than 15 means amount of air is more, amount of fuel is less. So air fuel ratio more than 15, it is carrying excess air. The left hand side of this one having less amount of air, more amount of fuel, it is having excess fuel. These regions are rich regions. This is rich zone, this side is lean zone, and there are flammability limits also, limits of flammability. Meaning of this one is, if air fuel ratio is less than 9, because availability of oxygen is very low, it is said that whatever the source of ignition may be, if it is spark ignition engine, whatever the source of ignition may be, whatever the intensity of spark may be, the mixture won't burn, the combustion won't start, because here excessive fuel is available, availability of oxygen is very less. So this is lower flammability limit. 9 to 1 is lower flammability limit, means if air fuel ratio is less than 9, no combustion will be there inside the cylinder. Similarly, on the right hand side, if you see this limit here, this limit here after 15, 16, 17, 18 something. So after 18, when mixture is becoming very lean, excessive air is there, less amount of fuel is available. Again, we are saying here higher flammability, this is lower flammability limits, it is higher flammability limits, whatever the source of ignition may be. Because availability of fuel particles are very less as compared to availability of oxygen particles, whatever the source of ignition may be, combustion won't be initiated. So in the case of spark ignition engine, 15 is chemically correct, 9 to somewhere 18.5 is the flammability limit. So between these ranges, 9 to 18.5 combustion can take place. So these are termed as limits of the combustion or flammability limits of the fuel. Another difference between the air standard cycle and pure air cycle is dissociation. When this compression process is going on, when heat is being added, when combustion starts, theoretically if combustion starts, the peak temperature which you are receiving inside the cylinder, this is the peak temperature. Yes, this is the peak temperature. If you are adding heat at constant volume, heat addition is there. If fuel is burning at constant volume, heat will be added. It can reach up to 3, say theoretically. But in actual cases, when fuel is burning, the combustion products which are there, particularly when CO2 formation is there, immediately CO2 dissociates. When temperatures are quite high, it is getting converted into CO and O2. This dissociation process, this conversion process of CO2 into CO plus O2, it needs some heat. It is taking some heat, and that's why the actual temperature which we are receiving into the cylinder, the peak, this value will be this one, not this one. Theoretically, if there would not have been any dissociation, your peak temperature would have been somewhere around 3000 degrees Celsius. But if dissociation is taking place, this peak temperature is significantly lower than 3000 degrees Celsius. Yes. So this is dissociation. Dissociation is also deviating air standard cycle from fuel air cycle, because fuel is actually burning inside the cylinder. It is creating many of the reactions in the fuel. Many reactions are taking place in forward direction, in reverse direction, and some of the reactions need heat addition. Some of the heat reaction are rejecting the heat. They are exothermic reactions, some of are endothermic. So when the reaction is endothermic, it won't allow temperature to reach up to this, but during that process it is absorbing some heat and it is keeping the temperature of cycle significantly lower as compared to if it would have been air standard cycle. When mixers are lean to this side, when it is lean, chances of CO2 formation will be significantly higher. Complete combustion chances will be higher because availability of oxygen is larger. So here the dissociation process will be very fast. The temperature difference, theoretical temperature and actual temperature which you are receiving into the cylinder, that difference is significantly higher. On the richer side, if you see, when availability of fuel is more, when fuel particles are more, when carbon particles are more, availability of oxygen is less, this richer side. When availability of oxygen is less, then there will be CO formation. The CO formation won't allow the dissociation to take place. If dissociation is not taking place, then the difference between these two will be lesser. So in towards richer side, dissociation is slower. Towards leaner side, the dissociation is very fast, and its speed is highest when there is chemically correct mixture. If chemically correct mixture we are having, then dissociation is very rapid, and difference between this temperature and this temperature is significantly higher. Sometimes this temperature is termed as adiabatic flame temperature also. As compared to this adiabatic flame temperature, the actual temperature inside the cylinder will be lower. If combustion is taking place inside an insulated space, no heat exchange will be taking place, and the processes will be taking place without any heat exchange to surrounding. So this temperature will also be equal to adiabatic flame temperature. So this is also one deviation. One deviation we have observed due to variation in specific heat. Another variation between air standard cycle and fuel air cycle we are observing due to dissociation. Now actual cycles. One we said air standard cycle, another one we said fuel air cycle, third one is actual cycle. Even some more losses are there, more variations are there of in actual cycle as compared to fuel air cycle also. So whenever we are comparing all the three cycles. One is ideal cycle, air standard cycle, then when effect of the variation of specific heats and dissociation we are considering, we are achieving fuel air cycle. And here we are assuming that working fluid is not only air, it is air plus fuel. Now next you see in actual processes which are taking place, not only these losses which are observed due to the variation in specific heat and due to dissociation process, many many more losses are there, particularly heat transfer, that is cooling. In actual cases, in actual cycles, it may be diesel engine, it may be petrol engine, lot of heat has to be transferred to cooling water, to air. So cooling losses are there. Then exhaust gases which are going out from the cylinder, their temperatures are significantly higher. Even their temperature may be around 400 degrees Celsius. In petrol engine, the exhaust temperature may be 500 degrees Celsius. In the case of diesel engine, it is around 380, 370 degrees Celsius. So significantly higher temperatures exhaust gases are having. It means they are carrying lot of heat while they are going into the atmosphere. This is also the wastage. And then friction, radiation, etc. Friction between cylinder and piston. Then taking fresh mixture into the cylinder, exhausting the burnt products from the cylinder. All these processes are needing some work, and it is wastage. So actual work output which we are getting, it is only 34% of the total heat which we have supplied. Remaining 30% is going in cooling, around 26% is going in exhaust, and 10%. Remaining miscellaneous losses which are there, that is there. So under when balance sheet, when we are making in balance sheet, this 100% heat which we supplied, out of that one only 30% has been converted into useful output which we are getting on the brake power, on the crankshaft we are getting. Around 30% we are losing in the cooling processes. In exhaust gases, around 26% is going, and miscellaneous losses are 10%. This is termed as heat balance sheet of an engine. This is when combustion is taking place, when combustion inside the cylinder is taking place, some of the heat is being transferred through cooling water. Another one, outside temperature is atmospheric temperature. Here all the walls inside the cylinder temperatures are significantly higher. So due to this temperature gradient, some of the heat will be transferred due to radiation also. Some of the heat will be transferred due to convection also. Lot of heat transfer is taking place from the engine cylinder to surrounding. So this is also loss. When heat balance sheet we are making, we are calculating this heat loss from the cylinder. Another loss which we are observing, in the case of petrol engine, we are supplying the homogeneous air fuel mixture into the cylinder. Combustion has taken place here with the help of spark plug. Then flame is propagating towards the cylinder wall, from this side also, from this side also, towards piston also. This flame propagation is taking place near the cylinder walls, because cooling water is flowing in the cylinder walls. So near cylinder walls, temperatures are significantly lower. This side temperatures are significantly lower. So when flame is propagating towards this side and near the cylinder wall, when they are meeting with the significantly lower temperature, there are chances that flame may quench. Flame may not continue, it may quench somewhere. When it will be quenched near cylinder walls, the significant amount of fuel may remain unburned. It won't be taking part in combustion, the fuel won't be taking part in combustion, and that left out, the leftover fuel air which it is there, which has not taken part in combustion, when exhaust valve will be opened during exhaust stroke, that unburned fuel will be going out into the atmosphere. So that is also loss. Unburned fuel which remains into the cylinder due to quenching of flame is also a loss. In the case of diesel engines, spray of the fuel is taking place in many of the areas. Mixture may be very rich, many of the areas only air will be there, mixing is not proper. So partly burnt mixture which couldn't get air particles into the cylinder, oxygen particles into the cylinder, they may remain unburnt. Partially burnt fuel particles will be going out through exhaust process. So this is wastage. So and the unburnt fuel which remains into the cylinder is one of the reason for having lesser efficiency, or when we are reaching towards the actual cycle, this loss is also significant as compared to fuel air cycle. When these losses we are considering, one we said heat transfer losses, another one we said unburnt fuel which is there, and third loss which we are saying, the heat addition process. Heat addition process in ideal cycle we say B to C. This is a TDC. From B to C, at constant volume, heat is being added. Yes, rapidly heat is being added. This is compression process. This is expansion process. From B to C is heat addition. Here we are indicating crank angle, theta. So this axis is pressure, this axis is theta. Here we are saying piston is at top dead center without consuming any time, piston is stationary, and that time the heat has been added. Theoretically, heat has been added between B and C when volume is constant. In the case of Otto cycle, we are assuming constant volume heat addition. This is ideal process. But in actual case, in actual heat addition process, here you see theoretically we have assumed heat addition is at constant volume. Whatever heat we are having, we have added. Speed of the piston is zero, that we have assumed. Even heat rejection also we have assumed at constant volume. But in actual case here you see, here if I am indicating pressure and theta diagram, somewhere at this point we have started to give spark to air fuel mixture. This one is TDC. Before TDC we have initiated the spark, and as per the previous assumption, as we have given spark, immediately whole fuel air mixture should burn. Yes, it is the heat, theoretically it is being released at constant volume, means whole fuel which we have supplied to the cylinder without consuming any time, the flame is propagating inside all of the cylinder, no time it has taken, and total heat has been rejected at constant volume. But in actual case, this doesn't happen. After putting the spark, significant time is required for completion of the chemical reaction of the fuel, then flame propagation will start, slowly it will be moving towards the cylinder walls. It will take time. The combustion duration may be 30 to 40 degree, 45 degree of the crankshaft rotation. So significantly longer combustion duration in actual cycle it is. So if longer the combustion duration, the loss of the power will be. Theoretically, our peak pressure should have been at TDC if heat addition is at constant volume. But in actual cases, the peak pressure is coming after top dead center, till that time piston has moved significantly towards the bottom dead center. So efficiency of the cycle will be decreasing due to this duration of combustion. Sometimes it is termed as time loss, because in combustion process some time is needed, it is losing some work output of the engine, it is time loss. So as compared to fuel air cycle, one we said heat transfer is taking place, another one we said significant amount of mixture remains unburned during combustion, third one we said time loss, the combustion is taking place some time. So these are the differences, these are the losses which are making actual cycle different from fuel air cycle. One I said time loss, I already explained. Second one I said heat losses, that I explained. Blow down losses I'll be explaining, blow by loss I'll explain, rubbing friction loss between cylinder and piston, there is friction, that also, pumping loss for taking fresh mixture into the cylinder and exhausting the burnt products from the cylinder, it also needs some power. So these are major six losses which are making fuel air cycle and actual cycle different. Which as compared to air standard cycle, fuel air cycle was different, it was having lower efficiency. And as compared to fuel air cycle, this actual cycle is very, very different, significantly different, and its efficiency is much lower than the fuel air cycle. One is time loss. I am saying for addition of heat, some time is needed. And that time depends upon what air fuel ratio we are having, what is the diameter of the cylinder, what is the speed of the engine. Many, many parameters are there which are affecting these time losses. But it is true that heat addition is not taking place at TDC, it is starting before top dead center, it is ending significantly after top dead center, and peak pressure is not coming at top dead center, it is coming slightly after top dead center. So one reason for the deviation between fuel air cycle and actual cycle is this time loss. Then I am saying heat losses inside the cylinder, temperatures are significantly higher, atmospheric outside temperatures are lower, lot of heat is being rejected, significant amount of heat is rejected with cooling water also. So this is again a significant loss, this heat losses I am saying. Inside the cylinder, various parts are having different temperatures, but their temperatures are higher than atmospheric temperature. Even temperature of exhaust valve, which is the having highest temperature in the engine cylinder mechanism, its temperature is 650 degrees Celsius, very high temperature. Exhaust manifold is having temperature 450 degree Celsius. Exhaust products which are going out, it is at 450 degree Celsius. Even the air which is being sucked, the temperature of the intake manifold due to the conduction, the temperature of induction manifold is also significantly higher. This temperature is also higher. Piston temperature is higher than atmospheric temperature, 300 degrees Celsius. So every component is having temperature higher than atmospheric. Always there is heat exchange from the cylinder. Whatever the stroke may be, even in suction stroke, even in exhaust stroke, even in compression stroke, lot of heat is being transferred, that is loss. So this heat loss is making actual cycle much more different from fuel air cycle. Then blow down losses. The blow down losses are, our requirement is when expansion stroke has completed, when power stroke has been completed, the exhaust valve should open so that all the burn products which are available inside the cylinder during exhaust stroke should go out from the cylinder. All the burn products should go out. No burn product should remain inside the cylinder. But making them out from the cylinder needs some time. So in actual engines, what we are doing, in place of opening exhaust valve at bottom dead center, we start to open this exhaust valve before bottom dead center. But that time pressure inside the cylinder is significantly higher. And that pressure, when we are opening the exhaust valve, that high pressure, those high pressure gases are going out. Otherwise, they would have produced some work on the piston. But because we want that during exhaust process, all the burn products should go out, they need significant time for going out. So opening of the exhaust valve is before bottom dead center. Some power is being wasted due to this one, because high pressure gases has to be exhausted. This loss is termed as blow down losses. The hypothetically, this expansion would have been, this line, it would have been followed. But when actually, when we are opening the exhaust valve before bottom dead center, the line which is being followed during expansion process, it is this line, this lower line. So this difference is loss of power. In PV diagram, this loss is due to this blow down, because we have opened up the exhaust valve before bottom dead center, and all the energy of the burn products has not given power to piston. Another loss is, significant loss is, one side of the piston due to combustion, it is having very high pressure. Even at the time of compression, this side pressure will be higher. This side of the piston is having atmospheric pressure. Due to that one, some of the high pressure gases may leak towards this crankcase side. From the combustion chamber to crankcase, some leakage of the unburnt gases is taking place. They have not released their energy, but they have come into this crankcase, and the crankcase is vented to atmosphere. So these unburnt fuel air particles will be going out into the atmosphere. This is wastage of energy. This is during compression, they are going out. This is during combustion, they are going out. So this is loss of power also. These losses are blow by losses. So these losses are also significantly higher. Then rubbing friction loss. I am saying between cylinder and piston, there are piston rings, they are attaching to cylinder walls. Between them, significantly higher friction it is there. This friction also depends upon what is the speed of the engine, what material of the piston cylinder, what type of lubricating oil we are using. So on those parameters, this rubbing friction loss depends, but this value is also significantly higher. Then this pumping loss. This area is useful output. This is indicated power. But this region where exhaust is taking place above atmospheric pressure, the dotted line which I am showing here, it is atmospheric pressure line. When you opened up exhaust valve here, burn products are going out. They are going out above atmospheric pressure. And when fresh mixture always is entering inside the cylinder lower than atmospheric, means vacuum is being created. So this area, one is during suction vacuum is created, exhaust is taking place above atmospheric, this area is negative area, it is pumping loss. So this loss is also quite high. So on fuel air cycle, if I am superimposing actual cycle, this line is actual cycle line, this line. Outermost line, dotted line, is fuel air cycle. Now, the output which we are getting from fuel air cycle as compared to actual cycle lines are giving less power output. The area of this PV diagram will be lesser. Reason for that one is this heat transfer. Due to heat transfer, the expansion line deviates, it is having lower values, combustion losses, the time losses, this much energy we are wasting due to time losses, combustion needs some time, so this loss it is there. Then blow down losses are explained due to the opening of the exhaust valve before bottom dead center, and this one is pumping losses. So on pressure volume diagram, if you are showing clearly, these losses are indicated here. It means this area of actual cycle is far far lower as compared to fuel air cycle. So highest area is having air standard cycle, lesser than this, slightly lower it is fuel air cycle, and lowest area actual cycle. Actual cycle, when all the losses of the cycle are considered, it is actual cycle. In terms of percentage, if I am saying around 6% losses due to time losses, due to combustion duration, heat losses around 12% I am saying, and the cycles are compared here. This is fuel air cycle, this is actual cycle. Even the blowdown losses, exhaust losses, it is around 2%. So significant losses are there, and this difference, this is making difference, significant difference between fuel air cycle and actual cycle. This is indicated engine load. I am showing you a throttle valve. In the case of petrol engine, this throttle valve, say opening of the throttle valve is say 100%. Here in this case 100% opening is there. When air fuel mixture is entering into the cylinder, the obstruction of this valve is minimum. This is full load. When it opening of the throttle valve is 100%, engine is termed as fully loaded, 100% loaded. If 50% opening of the throttle valve is, this throttle valve is say remain roughly half closed, half open, then load on the engine is 50%, or sometimes say part load. Part load is throttle is partly open. If fully open, it is full load. These are the magnitudes of losses. So first of all, in this table you see air standard cycle and efficiency of this cycle. Full load means I am saying throttle is fully open. Half load I am saying throttle is partly open. So when air standard cycle we are considering, because in air standard cycle there is no question of throttle and all. So whatever efficiency it is giving, efficiency means thermal efficiency, whatever thermal efficiency it is giving at full load, same it is at half load. As compared to this one, now losses are coming. From air standard cycle to fuel air cycle we are reaching, one is due to variation of specific heat and chemical equilibrium, these losses are 13%. Means due to change in specific heat and due to dissociation, the losses which are there, they are around 13%. It may be full load, it may be half load. So efficiency of fuel air cycle is, fuel air cycle efficiency is 56.5 minus 13, it is 43.5. So as compared to air standard cycle, fuel air cycle is 13% lower efficiency due to the variation in specific heat and the dissociation. So 43.5. then remaining losses are, one is loss to due to progressive combustion, the time required in the combustion, the time losses. Then we said incomplete combustion, flame has not reached to the cylinder wall, some fuel remains unburned. This is also 3% at full load, half load. Then it is direct heat loss around 4%. The potential difference of temperature between cylinder and outside, if temperature, if the load is lesser, that time the losses will be much more, because piston is running at a lower speed, throttle is partly open, so losses may be more because speed of the piston is lower. Then we are saying exhaust blowdown losses around 0.5% due to opening of the exhaust valve before bottom dead center, pumping losses, taking fresh mixture into the cylinder and exhausting them out from the cylinder. This pumping losses at part load, it will be much more because throttle valve is remains in closed position. It is not allowing mixture to enter into the cylinder while piston is trying to take that mixture into the cylinder. When piston is moving in downward direction during suction stroke, but fresh mixture is not entering at the rate at which piston wants, because obstruction of throttle valve is there. Due to that one, the suction line becomes much more lower than atmospheric. So area of the pumping loop will increase when load on the engine is lower or throttle opening is lesser. So that loss will be around 1.5%. Then we are saying rubbing friction loss. If it is at full load, rubbing friction loss is 3%. at part load it may become 6%, because then when speed of the piston is lower, when load is less, speed is less, that time even lubricating temperature, oil temperature may decrease, it may create the friction between cylinder and piston. Your lubricating oil also become the friction agent when temperatures inside the cylinder are lower. So friction losses may become much higher when load is lesser. So this 43.5 minus the loss due to progressive combustion, loss due to incomplete combustion, direct heat loss, and exchange, this exhaust blowdown, if we are adding all together, and if I subtract from 43.5, that is fuel efficiency, this 2, 3, 4, 5, the serial number 2, 3, 4, 5, if I add all together and I subtract from fuel air cycle, this will give us the gross indicated thermal efficiency of actual cycle. Of actual cycle, indicated thermal efficiency is 34%. But still some more losses are there. This 6 and 7 which has been left, pumping losses and friction losses. If I take them in account, if I considering them and if I subtracting them from this indicated thermal efficiency, this 6 plus 7, this will be 0.5 and 3.5. So if I subtract 32 minus 3.5, it will be 28.5. This is actual brake thermal efficiency. So indicated thermal efficiency minus losses due to pumping loss and friction losses, if you are subtracting, it is becoming brake thermal efficiency. Very important term here. We have defined indicated thermal efficiency. We have defined indicated mean effective pressure. Now we are defining in this actual brake thermal efficiency, indicated thermal efficiency minus pumping losses, minus friction losses, it is giving us the actual brake thermal efficiency. The efficiency which you are getting on the crankshaft, this efficiency, it is inside the cylinder, over the piston we are getting, this we are getting over the crankshaft, indicated thermal efficiency. The ratio of this brake thermal efficiency divided by indicated thermal efficiency gives very important term, that is known as mechanical efficiency. Mechanical efficiency is brake thermal efficiency divided by indicated thermal efficiency. It is around 80%. So these are the differences between air standard cycle, fuel air cycle, and actual cycle. Some of the two, three small questions I'll be giving you here. The actual efficiency of a good engine is about of the estimated air fuel cycle efficiency. It is said that actual efficiency and air fuel cycle efficiency, roughly what is the change? So answer, correct answer is actual efficiency is 80% of the fuel efficiency, 85% of the fuel efficiency. So answer B is correct. Actual efficiency is 0.85 of fuel air cycle efficiency. Second one, fuel air efficiency is less than air standard efficiency by an amount equal to. So difference between air standard efficiency and fuel efficiency is the loss due to specific heat change and chemical equilibrium, that is dissociation. So two changes were there between fuel air cycle and air standard cycle, that is loss due to specific heat changes and chemical equilibrium, which we said it is dissociation, that loss. So C is correct here. Fuel air ratio affects maximum power output to engine due to higher specific heats, chemical equilibrium, both chemical equilibrium as well as specific heat. So all of the mentioned means earlier A and B, if I combine here, so correct answer is C. A and B both are correct. As compared air cycle in actual working, the effect of variation in specific heat is to the variation in specific heat we have seen on the PV diagram. It is reducing the pressure, it is reducing the temperature. So B is correct. It will reduce maximum pressure and maximum temperature in the cycle. Thank you. Next time, as now we have defined here mechanical efficiency, we have got brake thermal efficiency, we have got indicated thermal efficiency. On the basis of this one, we'll be doing detailing of this mechanical efficiency. Same time, we'll define one new term, that is brake mean effective pressure. Thank you.